Good afternoon, everyone. My name is D'Artagnan Miller, and I will be your moderator for the Obama Presidency panel discussion. It's an honor to be here on the campus of Archbishop Shaw. With us, we have John Martin.
Hello, my name is John Martin. I wrote the book, 8 Monumental Years, Obama's Legacy, and it's great to be here with you.
We also have Carter Newsham.
Hi, how are you doing? Great to be here. I wrote the New York Times bestseller, What is Obama's Last Name?
And next, we have Gavin Richard.
Good evening. I wrote Obama, the charismatic commander-in-chief, and I would like to say thanks for waiting for my plane to show up tonight.
And finally, we have Mikhail Richardson.
Hello, how are you doing? And I wrote the book, Why Barack? And I'm a pleasure to be here and talk about this deceitful expert.
Okay, so we'll begin with the question, how did the stimulus check affect the economy? So, John?
When it comes to the stimulus check of 2009 affecting the economy, it took out about $831 billion from our resources, but it affected us great well. Economists even say it reduced unemployment and the benefits outweighed the cost. It was able to help a lot of people in need at the time because of the recession in that era, and I think it was a great benefit to us. That's all I have to say.
I think it was a very smart decision. We saw great increases in the GDP. Obama, he did very well with that one. Coming out of the recession, was a very smart and strategic move to get the workforce going and get those cars out and produce and do a lot of other good things.
Yeah, I would like to say it was a great decision on Obama's part, considering he just became president. Inaugurated a month before, and to make a decision like that that eventually helped Americans in that moment get necessary money for expenses that they needed, and eventually for the economy to grow in the following years, was really a great decision.
And to piggyback off of Mr. Richard, the stimulus check created a lot, 1.6 million more jobs for unemployed or people looking for jobs, but it also increased the unemployment rate by 6.6%, which I don't really agree with.
Okay, I
don't
think.
I'd also like to say it's notable how no House members of the Republican Party voted for it, showing that this was a very divisive decision on Obama's part to bring this forth. And it's, you could say, brave of him, especially just coming into office to put such a controversial bill up and be willing to back it so heavily.
Now we'll open up a discussion to the audience. Mr. Evans.
Hi, how you doing? My name is Tristan Evans. First off, I just want to ask, how do you think Obama and his forces were so successful in eliminating Osama bin Laden?
I think it's a very, very simple answer to that question. It's America's most powerful nation in the world. We have been since World War II. We saw a threat that needed to be eliminated, and we did. And that was a very good decision by him because he acted swiftly and decisively to end a situation that needed to be before anyone allowed him to take it. And did it extremely effectively. SEAL Team 6 went in, executed their mission, got out with minimal casualties, minimal losses. So,
optically, it was really good for Obama as well because defeating this big bad terrorist organization leader boosted his popularity amongst both Democrats and Republicans, making him far more popular than his adversaries at the time.
Hey.
This is Josh.
So this question is dedicated specifically to John, but all of you can answer. Do you support all of the stimulus checks made by Biden and Obama, or no?
No, I would not say that I support a majority of the stimulus checks signed on by Biden because of their ramifications to our current debt that we have accumulated over time. Though other countries may have more or less debt depending, still, boosting our debt is never a good idea unless absolutely necessary. In some of the cases with Biden, it wasn't entirely necessary to boost that debt ceiling. But with the stimulus check right here, that was signed in by Obama, I feel it was really good. It really made our economy soar after that. So, yeah.
So, even though the unemployment rate went up, you still support it?
For this stimulus, 2009 one in particular, I'd say it affected us in a great way. I'd say most economists support it as well, so I usually take my stance with them and the data that backs it.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Collins. This is Dr. Trey.
Good afternoon, I'm Zachary Tran. This is a general question to anyone. So for the 2008 presidential election, what do you think made Obama think he had what it takes to become president with very little experience, especially as a small senator from Illinois?
One thing I think that encouraged him was being black. I think that he understood the need for the diversity in the, I think he understood the need for diversity in the political space of America, especially at the time in 2009, coming out of recession. He saw a need in unrelated to race, I think he saw a need that he could solve. And he, as he started probably talking about it, he probably saw that he snowballed into popularity with the public and saw that he could prosper in this election and do a lot for America.
I would say that he was able to see that he was making progress with the public, mainly because of the fact that the way he knew how to talk to Americans, and that he was very charismatic and very choiceful with what he would say, and he knew what the Americans wanted to hear, and so when he'd say it, they latch onto it and fall.
I feel like it was just an agenda that they wanted to push. I mean, it looks good in the eyes of the public, where they have we've never seen an African American president before, so just him being black, as the piggyback on Mr. Lucian, it was just something different, something that let people enjoy.
I feel that Obama being black was definitely not a, for the Democratic Party, them supporting him was definitely a purposeful decision in him being black, and never having an African-American president before is definitely something that was monumental at the time, and compared to his adversary, who didn't have much going for him. Besides, he was a war hero. It really made him stand out, along with his charisma, of course. But it had a big effect on whether he became president or not.
Thank you, Mr. Trey. Mr. Trey.
Hey, good afternoon, gentlemen. I have a question more specifically to John Martin. But so you mentioned that we pulled $831 billion of funding for stimulus check 2009 from resources. Can you elaborate more on what are these resources exactly that you're pulling these funding from?
Resources, that being taxes and government funds accumulated, mostly through taxes. I mean, there are other sources of gaining that wealth, you know, trade and all that. But overall, these taxes, I think, you know, they were used directly to benefit the public in from the stimulus in 2009. This went out directly to the public for the most part. It also went to help some certain small businesses as well, which definitely boosted our economy, I think. Just because it was taxation doesn't inherently make it a bad thing, that, especially since it went back to the public. Not saying they made that argument, of course. Just clarifying.
Thank you, Mr. Graham. Oh, Mr. Valentine.
Was tightening sanctions on Iran effective at punishing firms who aid Iran's petroleum sector?
I'd say it was pretty effective. I mean, if you're going against a big power in a war, as we did against Iraq, you would want to withhold resources from them, which being money to gain oil from them, and in taking those resources away, we did benefit us because not only did they not have as much money or resources as us, but they also, in the United States, Iraq had a very strong trade partner. So in total, I'd say that it was a very good decision strategically when it comes to the war. Yes.
I would just like to make clarification. Did you say Iran or Iraq?
Iran.
I feel that Iran is a big opponent, as we saw President Trump have to address in numerous instances, and I feel that Obama did leave more windows in Iran's opportunity, giving Iran an opportunity to hurt the United States in a lot of ways, and I feel that President Trump came in, saw those windows, and closed them up, but I feel that if we could close those sooner, then a lot less damage would be done.
My name is kind of just a general question for the entire panel. What were the main factors that led to Obama's dominant victory in his re-election over Mitt Romney?
We have to remember that Obama, when he was president, it was a before Trump era in which a lot of our presidents weren't as divisive as they are now. As you can see with our recent presidents, Trump and Biden, they've been very divisive, led to a lot more political talk than in our past eras. And the one person who came before him was Obama. Obama tried his best to take firm stances while not purposely trying to hurt his opposition in a way that would not benefit him extremely well. So,
thank you.
Hi, my name is Tristan Bartlett. My question is, do you believe that signing the Paris Climate Agreement in Obama's presidency led to any everlasting changes? And how do you feel that now, since Biden has put us back into that agreement?
I feel that in a lot of ways, the Paris Climate Agreement was a success, but there's also a lot of instances where it was a failure. One failure being China. And China is long in part with India, being the biggest polluters in the world. Them not holding to those standards and not seemingly agreeing and participating in what was going on in the Paris Climate Agreement, I think that just negates all effects. I feel that the European aspect, Europe is so small. Whereas, yes, Europe does have a lot of industry, I feel that it's so small in comparison that it has no effect as to the effects in Europe, in Asia, in the apart, as well as the United States. The United States, whereas we are a big polluter, we're nowhere near to the sheer mass that in China is. Between India and China, that's almost a third of the population. So I think if there is an ability now that President Biden puts back in, if he can get in talks with those Asian countries, China and India, and get them involved and get them to actually participate, I think it will be a success, but for now, no.
Now, I would like to rebuke what Carter said in regards to participation, because the Paris Agreement states directly that the countries are allowed to set their own goals of their own reducing on carbon emission. It does not specify for each country, as it is individualized depending on, you know, how much they emit already, how much they would like to take back. But it does state directly that by 2030 they would like to cut the emissions by 50% of whatever the original Paris Agreement had. So while it may not be that China and India are participating as much as we'd like them to, we can only hope that they will bolster their activities towards getting that reduced over time.
So my vote for that would be saying that the goal is for 2030, and we've seen the trends. China's not going to, we can obviously tell that China's not going to stop in the goal of being the number one economic producer in the world. We can, that's very obvious to see from all parties and all sides. That's just an obvious. So whenever you're looking at the situation, you're saying, let's just hope that in 6 to 7 years, that China can just magically flip it like a light switch and then just completely stop. That's just childish in some ways, because that's just hoping for people who have no help, who are going to be long dead before the effects even hit them. That's just expecting them to care and want to participate. So.
Now, while I disagree with that point, seeing as the Paris Accords directly state that they are, besides being allowed to set your own goals, they do have one clause that says that you must have it, whatever your goal is must be more than the year before. So whenever you set a new goal per year, you have to make it more than before as not to suffer from any setbacks. So while they may be making little progress compared to us, they still have made progress nonetheless. And circling back to Obama, I think it was still a very smart decision for Obama to put us into the Paris Agreement, as it has allowed many other countries throughout the world to have a broader perspective when it comes to climate change and be able to actively participate in bringing down global warming and other such effects of climate change that have really harmed not only the economy, not only society, but our planet as well.
One thing I would have to say is just on where the consequences of leaving the Paris Accord. I mean, the United States left under President Trump, and there was seemingly no consequences. So what's stopping China from doing that next year or in 2029 when the re-evaluation comes up? I mean, there's nothing saying that, and there's no consequence built in. There's no action that can be taken against them for not fulfilling the clauses in the Paris Agreement.
I mean, yes, that is a good point, and I would say to that that you can't really put a sort of a punishment to each country, because each country has different circumstances, since a lot of countries are in there. So,
I do agree with that, but what I have to say is we're limiting ourselves in America.
I think we do.
I would like to open up the board for more questions. Thank you, Mr. Barber. Mr. Robles?
Good afternoon, my name is Robles. Bringing back the topic of bin Laden, would you consider it reckless for Obama to raid the suspected complex, which bin Laden did with inconclusive evidence?
I would say, based on the terrorist attacks that have been leading up to that point, which one of the main ones being 9/11, which really affected the nation and caused a lot of reform when Bush was president. I'd say that decision to raid that house was very necessary based on the events leading up to it. Now, let's take it from the opposite, where like all these things never happened beforehand. I would say yes, it would be reckless, but because of those previous events, I would say it was a necessary decision.
I would also have to agree with this picture. It is an extremely necessary event. In American history, we have taken bigger steps with less information. There comes a point between the war and in the combat scenario where you're going to have to, where you're not going to be able to know everything going into a situation. There was no way that we knew what they had behind them. There was a way we could find out, but to a certain extent, we didn't know what they had at Omaha Beach, and we still had to go, and we knew what we had to do. So we have to. So there's going to always be that situation where you're going to go in the dark. But that's why we have night vision goggles. That's why we have the tools that we have, and that's why we are the most powerful country in the world, to just so that way, whenever those situations arise, we can face them head on and we don't have to back
down. I would also like to state it was a very important decision for Obama optically, as if he had not gone for this choice, which he did have some idea of what he was going into, as they had bases in the area, they had a lot of suspected reasons as to why he would be here if he was there or not. So whenever he went to, whenever he put into action, that it was a good decision for him optically, because having Obama defeat the greatest terrorist leader at the time is an amazing win for America. It really shows to other countries and to ourselves how powerful we are.
Thank you, Mr. Robles. Mr. Babson, where do you go? Please, Mr. Butler, back.
What are your thoughts regarding the immigration policies that were laid out by Obama?
Programs that allowed immigrants that were born here to stay for 2 years of mobility. I think that's just irresponsible. There's no way to. It comes to a certain point where you can't track some of these people down. It is good for some of those people that are honest and everything like that. But we cannot. There can't be a way to discern that. So, and I feel that America's consequences for illegal immigration are very mild in comparison to our European allies and everything like that. I mean, we see Britain, if you illegally immigrate in the EU, if you illegally immigrate in a lot of other countries, the punishments are a lot worse than if you illegally immigrate to the United States. And I feel that there is a too soft of a stance on illegal immigration in the United States. And I feel that Obama just bolstered the idea that it's okay to come here illegally. And if you have kids here, we'll let them go. We'll just let them stay and your kids are going to be fine, but you might end up getting deported, which a lot of people are willing to take that risk, and a lot of people are willing to do that and let their kids be in America when that's not the case, and that's not what we need.
America is a very strong country, a very big country as well, and so to be able to have more people come in will help us economically, especially with our current unemployment rate. It would be better to let immigrants in to allow them to take up some of the jobs that are not being taken by Native Americans in here, not people born in America,
I also feel it was pretty harsh because the people that were being sent back to their countries were the adults and the kids. The kids were being left alone by themselves. So I do feel it was pretty harsh that Obama didn't do half of the things he said he was going to do that tied into the immigration thing. But, it's pretty half and half, I would say.
Obama,
thank you, Mr. Cook. This is for me.
This question is specifically for Mr. John Martin, but any of you feel free to answer. Do you think that Obama had in mind the high tax premiums needed to pay for Obamacare when he initially put it in place?
I believe that Obama did have those in mind, definitely, as it Obamacare had it reduced income inequality by taxing certain people in particular with Obamacare. The statistic I had found was it taxed $600 on average from the top 1% for the families on average of the lower 40%, which by taking from these richer individuals allowed him to pay for the coverage of 20 to 24 million people in that lower 40%.
But to rebuke Mr. Martin, say, wouldn't that technically be discrimination, saying you have to take from one person to give to another? Now, whereas they might have the ability and the economic fortitude to do so, I think that it's in some ways wrong to take from one and give to another.
Well, they are living in this country. They pay taxes for living here and on their property in general, and so those taxes can be taken to be used for whatever the American government likes in terms of whether to give it to poor individuals to help them out or to be given for roads to be built.
Why? Well,
excuse me. we can come back to that question later. I would like to open the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Fan. Thank you, Mr. Fan.
Hi, I'm Michael Fan. This is for anybody. And I was wondering, do you think Obama's extension of same-sex rights, not only in everyday life, but also in the military, make our country stronger?
I necessarily don't think it makes our country stronger. I think it makes our country somewhat weaker. I feel like it's an agenda that the Democratic Party is trying to push to affect our children and our future. I mean, making it stronger, I don't understand how it would. It's important to have a mother and father dynamic in a certain household, so having two fathers to make a young, for example, a young boy, make him overly dominant or and maybe in some cases overly feminine, I don't see how it makes our country stronger.
I would have to agree with Mr. Richardson in some aspects. I also don't think Obama would think that makes the country stronger. We saw before President Joe Biden said that President Joe Biden, when he was vice president for Obama, he stated that marriage was between a man and a woman, and himself as well as President Obama agreed with that. But then later in Obama's presidency, we saw him switch sides. So I feel that deep down he doesn't necessarily agree with that. Could he have had a change of heart that is a genuine one? Yes, he could have. I personally think so. I also think that gay marriage, that the term marriage was something that was instituted for a religious, that had a religious aspect, and you just take that away, and I understand separation of churches, but then call it something else. Don't call it marriage, because that's not what it is. Marriage is between a man and a woman, as stated by the church.
Thank you, Mr. I'm sorry, we're running out of time, so Mr. Granger.
This is a general question. Obama made lots of changes in the education system. Following the Sandy Hook massacre, do you think Obama made enough changes with gun rights and gun violence for an end tragedy?
I would say that Obama made as much changes as he could. I mean, he signed 23 executive actions relating to gun control, and I would say that those are very effective in limiting the gun violence that we had in America at the time. He limited some assault weapons as well. So I would say it's at that effect. He did as much as he could, because at some point, the president can't make all the decisions and has to go through the House and the Senate. And so he did as much as he could.
While Obama did have a lot of opposition going against him, and I do recognize that, I think that Obama didn't push hard enough for the regulations that he did put in. As we can see in our modern day, we see mass shootings every other week, every other month, and it's very common nowadays. If you turn on TV, you'll likely see about mass shootings and such. And so I think just because of that fact alone, we can tell that he didn't do enough to stop it and nip it in the bud at that moment.
Also, to piggyback off John, there are a lot of mass shootings that don't get put on the news, I would say. There are shootings almost every day in Florida, Alabama, Texas, Louisiana, that you never hear about because, I mean, it's not super large, but, I mean, people still have access to guns. They can go on the dark web to get guns. You can get guns from anywhere. So, I mean, Obama's gun control policy, did he start something? Yes, but was it somewhat finished? I don't say no.
Thank you, Mr. Brandon.
Thank you. This is a question for the whole board. Do you think President Obama's student loan program worked, judging by the more than $1 trillion student debt total that was left behind when he left office?
I think there are a lot of economic decisions that President Obama made that were ill-advised. May have thought some things that were just simply not true. He's going to revise decisions, contributed to America's large increasing debt total. America right now, we're getting smothered by our debt, and one day it's going to come calling. So $1 trillion added, of course, it's not helpful. lot of ways. Whereas he tried to help, he didn't have the ability to, because he was neglecting the other aspect of put the money in the pocket, then just keep it.
I think that Obama supporting the student loan relief is actually a really important decision when it comes to America's future, as our unemployment rate is not as high as it used to be, but during the time of Obama is higher than our average now. And I believe that from that, I believe from that we can see that when it comes to America's future, having more educated and more employed people in higher positions such as doctors, chemists, engineers, is very important, and I think we should support that through giving them money to get that education.
Thank you, Mr. Monte. So this will be a question for the whole board. Despite numerous reports of various challenges to the Affordable Care Act, the health bill survived in 2015. So do you think that by this accomplishment, do you think it would work out as it intended to?
I feel that President Obama had a different vision for what we're doing with the disease. I feel that he thought it could be better. Now, whereas I understand that it did help a lot of people, and that's what it was designed to do, and it did help what it was designed to do for a lot of people and a lot of types of people, whereas I feel that in some ways the consequences did outweigh the benefits. I feel that President Obama did try with his bill, but I don't feel that it surpassed a level where I can say it was beneficial.
I believe it was very beneficial, as it decreased the cost of modern healthcare by putting a competing aspect to what some would call the big pharmacy industry, and it increased the quality. This competition from government has increased our pharmacy quality in the private sector quite heavily, and along with helping millions of people, of course you can make the argument that it did have a few negatives. I think overall it did pretty well.
Thank you, Mr. Wilson.
My question is, Obama invested in America's future by supporting renewable technology. Is this a good investment, and did renewable technology grow as much as it should have?
Can you expand on renewable technology?
Like things like windmills, like solar panels, stuff like that.
Renewable technology. So I would say that Obama did push for that initiative. However, I don't think it was the best decision, because while yes, fossil fuels are not renewable and they will run out eventually, for the time being that we still have them on this earth, I would say that they need to be used in order for the best possible outcome for the country where it is.
I would have to agree with Richard's points. There's a lot of ways that wind energy and solar energy cannot compete with the fossil fuels that are used. Petroleum is just, fossil fuels are king, and they will be for the next however long until the next energy source comes out of that.
Thank you, Mr. Brown. This will be our last one.
Hi, hello. My name is Kevin. This is about African American. Do you think that Obama maybe African Americans have better lives in general?
I believe that Obama put on a facade for African Americans to have a better life. Because, I mean, to have an African American president, and then the masses see that we have an African American president, I guess they would feel somewhat welcome that they have him, or somewhat supported, but all in all, was he really for the people?
I feel that President Obama, whereas seeing a familiar face in the White House, thing, but no, I don't specifically, I wouldn't specifically say that Obama did do anything to make the lives better.
I would agree with both things. Many critics of Obama's presidency would say that he left office with race relations worse than he came into it with. So I would agree with both points to say where Obama, the familiar face would help, but he didn't do much actual action for African Americans.
Thank you, Mr. Walker. I also want to thank the campus Archbishop.